Okay, so welcome back, everyone. Thanks for sticking around. Welcome if you're tuning in from your Facebook at home. Once again, I'm Chloe Kernahan.
I'm Krissy Jones.
I'm Robin Berkeley.
I'm Ellie Burrows.
So we're lucky to have Robin and Ellie today. They're two of our good friends that are also in the wellness world. Krissy and I have our studio downtown in New York City in Tribeca and in Chinatown. And maybe Robin and Ellie, you can give like a brief introduction of who you are and what you do.
My name is Robin Berkeley, as I said, and I am co-founder of a wellness brand called Live the Process. Live the Process is a content commerce site experience specializing in all areas of wellness from as seen from a modernist lens. And in addition, we also have activewear that we sell. It's all about layering and knits and very kind of ballerina, dance-inspired yoga, fitness gear for your everyday life.
We're huge fans.
Me too. I'm wearing some right now. Hi, I'm Ellie Burrows. I'm one of the co-founders of Mindful, and Mindful is New York City's premier meditation studio. Mindful exists to enable humans to feel good, and we do that by helping them build and or maintain a meditation practice. We have 35 expert teachers on staff, and they're all certified in different traditions and lineages that date back 2,500 years and older. So that means every teacher had a teacher that we can trace back thousands of years. So no one made anything up, you know, 6 weeks ago. We have three studios in the city. Our very first in Greenwich Village on 8th between 5th and University, on the Upper East Side on 60th Street, and in Williamsburg on North 8th and Driggs. Come visit. We'd love to see all of you there.
Cool. So I think what could be interesting for everyone to hear about, because we are all very much, I feel like, of this world. We're not necessarily like going off and sitting on mountaintops and like living our wellness life in the middle of nowhere. We're living in New York City and we're active individuals in our communities. Is maybe just how each of our practices has translated on like a daily life basis, because we've been able to start businesses, which, you know, is kind of counter to a lot of our practices in a lot of ways, you know, of being in like the business mindset of things. So maybe just considering like what are the balances that we work on a daily basis of how to weave in your practice into being a real human in New York City.
Sure. So Chloe and I own SKY TING YOGA, which is just a yoga studio. We do a lot of other modalities of healing, like massage at our space and sound baths and all of these types of things. But, you know, we started the business because we love the practice so much. It was really a dream that we had after studying together with the same mentor, Naveen Michon, and loving her material and wanting to continue to spread her teachings. And after opening up a business, there's all this stress that comes with opening up a business. And so when I do yoga now, it's like I did it for the first time. Like, it's so effective still, even though we do it all the time. And now I really rely on the practice to keep me grounded, so that, you know, our mission is staying strong, so that I don't get over my head and become a businesswoman. But it's like, oh no, the practice keeps me super grounded and able to handle the stress of New York City and the stress of working with other people and dealing with all the things that come with a business.
Totally.
Like having no heat in our space.
Yeah, we were just talking with our teacher this morning, and she was even saying, because she's now sort of moving into like a next stage of her life where she's doing less of like teaching public classes and more of just developing her own work. And she got away for a month with her husband, and she was just like, I just needed to go back to my practice. And it's like such an important reminder that, like, amidst all of the work that we're doing to, you know, progress everything forward, it's like you do need to just like check back into like your root source of like where you came from and why are you doing it in the first place, right? Which can sometimes feel overwhelming, but is often so much more important than anything else, is being true to who you are.
And because Chloe and I teach so many classes day to day, our practice of self-care becomes super important. We're working with a lot of different bodies and a lot of different people. We sometimes forget about ourselves, but until we take care of ourselves, that's like where the practice becomes somewhat selfish. It's like you actually have to take care of yourself so you have something to offer other people. So if you're always just giving, 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 you kind of deplete yourself and you might become bitter later. So a big defeat in life is becoming bitter, right. And we're not interested in that. We want to have nice lives. So we make sure that, you know, we take vacations, take a bath, or go to mindful, and do a practice.
So for me, I guess it was actually 6 years ago on Friday that I decided I wanted to change my life, and basically in its entirety, I kind of quit my job. I got really attached to yoga, and it was something that I would do, I guess, 3 to 4 times a week with friends as kind of more of a hobby, and I was like, I actually want to make this a bigger part of my life. And so I went and got yoga certified and went to Bali for about 3 months, which was amazing. And I felt there was this missing space because I kind of got really into nutrition and wellness, in lack of a better word, in all areas, from healing, from energy work, to, you know, just yoga practice and nutrition in general. And I felt there was this missing space, I guess this was 5 years ago, where when I had returned, that there was no space for that modern person who was living in a city to attach themselves to something that felt real, that wasn't telling you, these are the 10 things you need to do. And it was more of kind of a space that offered introspection and emotion and experience, and that everyone kind of is real and does have real issues, and it's kind of more your journey and getting through them, hence live the process. And so it was this kind of merging of content, and then not having any yoga clothing to wear for my entire teacher training, that I felt really feminine, really soft, really empowering, kind of celebrated the female body. And so I, you know, kind of paired those two up, and hence Live the Process was born. And that is not my full-time job, so I have a small PR company, and that takes up a lot of time. And so it's really about finding this balance and, you know, being able to be the best version of yourself. So mornings for me are really important. That's kind of my time. I definitely have my own yoga practice if I'm not going to do it at home. I'm very specific on kind of nutrition and eating and really taking care of myself. So the second I feel kind of out of whack or feel, oh, I need something, because I'm not gonna, as they said, I'm never gonna be that best version of myself if I don't take care of myself. And so that's really kind of the most important thing before kind of going and doing other things. So yeah.
Yeah, so I really agree with what Krissy was saying about showing up for your internal world so you can show up for your external one. And even though so much about meditation is practicing non-attachment, I am slightly rigidly attached to my self-care routine. And I kind of have to be. I'm also very forgiving if I happen to miss something or I don't get it right one day. That's sort of where the practice comes back in. But anyways, I practice meditation twice a day for 30 minutes. It's a mantra-based practice. It's the first thing I do when I get up in the morning. There's this joke that's around mindful called your RPM, and it's your rise, P, meditate. How long does it take for you to rise, go to the bathroom, and sit basically on the cushion or on your couch and practice in the morning? And from there, I know certain things about myself, like I need 8 hours of sleep to be 100% friendly. I need to put, you know, really good fuel in my body if I want to show up and be present for my very, very long workday, holding space for other people. And so meditation, exercise, moving my body, you know, feeling and responding to it. So maybe it's not, you know, hardcore cardio 6 days a week, but it's Pilates because I can feel my shoulders slumping over when I'm working at my computer. Or maybe it's yoga because my hips are feeling super tight. So really just, you know, kind of finding the space to get quiet enough so you can listen to what your body needs first, so you can take it places. It's an incredible vehicle that we're in all day long, driving around on the streets, on the subway, in taxis, however we're driving around. But anyways, I'd say the biggest challenge, similarly, is that every day we wake up and, like I said, we hold space for New Yorkers to learn how to practice meditation. And behind the scenes, we're a full-blown startup. So we're jumping through hoops. We're fixing computer crashes. We're making sure, you know, all the cushions are set, that there's enough toilet paper in the bathroom. And the people who come into our space, they don't always see this. And in order to, I guess the veil is very thin, and in order to maintain it, we really have to take care of ourselves. So, yeah.
And I think it's one of the things that people say to Chloe and I all the time is like, you guys must be so zen. Like, you're probably like, you probably never get angry. And it's like, oh no, we're actually real. Like, we're humans. That's why in our classes, like, we don't pretend to be gurus. Like, we play music and we're just ourselves. And we're just offering tools and techniques to help other people enhance their life in whatever it is that they do. So when you take care of your body, when you take care of your spirit, when you take care of your mind, it'll enhance whatever you do outside of the room. So we don't do yoga and teach yoga to get good at a pose. It's really not about that. It's really to give people techniques to have a better life. And what we've found by doing a practice is not that you don't get angry. It's not that you don't get, you know, I have moments where I'm like, oh, that, I'm embarrassed. Like, I acted like that. But you actually, like, recover more quickly when you have a practice where you realize where you're out of alignment with who you want to be, like your true self. So that's what we're discovering through this practice. And that's why it is a practice. You have to keep doing it and doing it and doing it for it to work, kind of like brushing your teeth. It's not like you do it one time and you're good for life.
Totally. And I think that's also, for Krissy and I personally, one of our drives with wanting to create Sky Ting was for us seeing, like, not a void in the marketplace, because there's definitely, especially in New York, so many amazing yoga teachers and yoga practices and studios already established. But what we were really interested in creating was taking what we have found to be just simple practical tools and techniques that will, like, help to give you a better life, to support you better. So for us, yoga is less of a philosophy of yoga is my life and it's the only thing that exists in my world. Rather, it's a way to enhance and support everything around me in my life and in my world. And we're at an interesting time right now, I think, overall in the spectrum of the wellness community, of wellness being such like a hype word and a hype trend of everyone being involved in wellness, you know? And it's so easy to lose track of what you're actually there to do, of it not being a popularity contest or just being a fad that we'll do for the next 2 years before it fades out and moves into the next, like, intense training of some kind, you know, or Instagram-worthy, da-da-da. And I feel like these two ladies as well, with the work that they're doing, their work is just honest, which I think is important to figure out and to find if you're part of the wellness community, like people that are actually speaking from honest and true places, of people that are doing the work themselves, which, you know, hopefully in the end, everyone deep down is doing the work honestly, but it's confusing, right? Sometimes you're scanning through Instagram and you're getting overwhelmed by all of this success almost, or this idea of success, that I think as young business owners, it's been an interesting line to walk where you don't let that be the drive of whether you're doing good or not. It's just like, no, just do the actual work, live in the actual process of it, as opposed to being goal-oriented of like, we have to get here by this point in order for it to be worth it. Because in the end, it's like, it's not worth it unless you're actually present in the work.
I think that's a really strong point. I feel like being your authentic true self and however your approach is most important, because that's where you're going to actually feel like you're not moving forward, but like moving along and kind of growing as a person. Because I can say that I never compare where I am in my life to anyone, just because it's really daunting and it's really, you know, you feel like, oh, well, I'm here and this person's here, but everyone has their own things that they deal with and their own kind of evolution. And so for me, I'm a learner, so I like to kind of learn as much as I can, and then as soon as I feel kind of empowered, then you move. You know, it's not about a race, you know, where you're like, oh my God, I need to get to that finish line, because there really isn't a finish line. It's really this journey where you're learning more about yourself, and then also what it is that you, after you learn this, how can you actually give back? And like, what is your purpose in that way? And you know, that's something that I kind of was trying to figure out, you know, in why I even started this, you know, a year and a half even before I left my job. It's like, what do I want to do? What makes me happy? What am I passionate about? And how do I want to live my life in the truest form? Because that's the only way, and for me at least, where I'd be like, oh, I feel happy. I feel empowered. I'm excited to wake up every day, and not every day is perfect. You have like a lot of, you know, things that, you know, you have to deal with, but you feel at least more grounded with where you are and kind of how you're going to grow.
Yeah, similarly to that, I was really struggling with my meditation practice, and one day I approached my friend, Lodra Rinsler, who is now my co-founder. I was volunteering for his nonprofit, and I asked him how come there wasn't a space in New York City where I could drop into a meditation class for 30 or 45 minutes in a way that fit in to my daily chaotic life living in New York City. Why do I have to go in and sit in on a two-hour talk or a full weekend or even a 10-day retreat? If I'm trying to really build a consistent practice, what does that actually look like, you know, in my daily life here in New York City? And I thought a lot about things I was able to show up for fully, like my workout, and I wanted to create that same accountability structure around my practice, an amazing community, a teacher I was looking forward to seeing, my favorite spot in the room, all those things, you know, that we all feel when we're going to our favorite studio or place of fitness or yoga or dance, all the things. So I think often, especially in this wellness world, especially because it's trending and it's hype, people are like, oh, I can't wait to start the next wellness business. And what should I do? You know? And I think, you know, I like to say to people, what do you need in your life? You know, start with what you need. Because if you need that, then chances are maybe the 8 million other people living in the city might also need that. So it really starts with you. I needed a place to go every day for my meditation practice. And here we are. I think about this also all the time, because I think about, you know, someone who created Uber. I don't even know his name. But one day he was probably like, oh, it would be so amazing if I could order a car on my phone. And here we are. Right. And now it's everywhere all over the world. So start with, yeah, something that you need, and watch the brush fire from there.
So I think we're going to open up to if anyone has any questions from you guys.
Anyway.
I have one. So what if I'm an entrepreneur too, so I just started acupuncture, which really helps with stress, that's true. But what if in the middle of my day, like, I have something happens and like intense peak of stress, which for me is really hard to let go of.
There's so many things you could do, so many techniques. But I think the easiest, the simplest advice I would give for that situation, which happens to me all the time, is to notice what your breath is doing. And chances are, if you're stressed out, your breath will be really high in your chest, and it'll be quick, and your shoulders will lift up, and there'll be all this tension in your neck. We're all like... and then just pay attention to that and see if instead of breathing from a place of anxiety, you can drop your breath low into your belly and take like a natural breath. Like if you ever watch a baby breathe, it's the belly that fills first, then the ribs, then the chest. And what happens when you're stressed out is the reverse happens. Your chest fills first. So just by switching your breath to start low into the belly, your nervous system will follow suit, and it'll start to wind down. And I think that's the quickest way to change the body's chemistry, which will change your state of mind. And practicing that in the morning before you wake up and before you go to bed. Our teacher, Allie Bogard, just told us to start doing that. And it's amazing how just that simple practice that everyone can do will change the day. Yeah. Your reaction to stress will be different.
I just also want to acknowledge you for, being able to be aware that that's even happening in your own body to begin with, because I think sometimes we get so wound up or down a rabbit hole that we don't even know that it's happening to us, right? So I think that's kind of one of the things that meditation can really help with, creating awareness around how we're feeling in any given moment. So the Tibetan word for meditation is gom, but it also means to become familiar with all of who you are. So meditation is a practice that helps us become familiar with all of who we are. So when we are feeling stressed, or we're feeling excited, or we're feeling scared, we have an ability to be like, oh, that's what's happening. I'm feeling nervous, I'm feeling scared. Wow, okay, I know how to self-soothe. So even having that awareness is super important. So I think you're off to a good start.
And I would say, I guess I totally understand kind of if you're in like a very stressful situation or you're negotiating something or if something happens and it comes from a client, for me, you have to let things roll off. You can't take them so to heart when it's happening. You have to think about kind of the events and leading up to it. And it's actually not, most of the time it's not you, it's something else that's on the exterior. So being able to actually like understand what that is, and then being able to be like, okay, this is just another thing in your mind. I'm gonna figure this out. They're throwing these things at me, or if I'm stressed for a reason, because it's usually, as I said, not really your stress, it's somebody else's stress, and being able to understand what that is and then just move on. And then I always think just taking a walk around the block, you just change your everything that's happening, and you can kind of come back and you're like, okay, this is, I'm back and I'm different and I'm fine, and then move forward.
So the question, the question was for people at home, what are the morning wellness routines? I can start. Similar to Ellie, I generally wake up, clean myself up in some way, and then sit and meditate for about 20 minutes. And then generally speaking, I try and have a routine of making my first meal at home, if it's allowed time-wise. So I'll make, a hot water with lemon, coffee at home, and then, whatever I might be eating for the day. And I try and allot myself enough time to actually enjoy that experience and not be just on the go, so that when I do step out of the door, I feel like more of a put-together individual. Because for you, years of teaching, you're like hustling and you're getting up real early and you're just on the go, like rolling out of bed. So I found to be able to have the time to put myself together makes the setup for the rest of the day a lot easier for me.
My wellness routine really is at nighttime, so I'm a big fan of taking a bath. almost do it every night. And then I do a practice of a restorative yoga practice of 20 minutes, very simple. And then I've been journaling lately, but like Chloe, I love to make some sort of warm, hot drink in the morning to set my day. And I try not to look at my phone right when I wake up, because your brain needs time to switch from being so relaxed to being like, go, 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 go. So I try to give myself the morning to not be on my phone, to not check my email until I'm out the door.
I would say morning is kind of my time, and I usually, spend like an hour and a half kind of, I've started to do a lot of Kundalini in the morning, which is, I don't know, I read Guru Jagat's book, and I've been kind of doing the cat-cow, like the fast pace for 2 to 3 minutes, and it literally wakes your body up, and you're ready to go. But I also do meditation. I'll do like some sort of home yoga practice, depending on if I'm not working out, because usually that's my time to, whether I go to the gym, whether I go to yoga, whatever it is. I'm not really a nighttime workout person because it makes me too wired. And then definitely I always kind of have some sort of breakfast or make some sort of food. sometimes smoothies. It depends. I'm always kind of also on like different nutrition plans a lot of the time. So it just depends on, you know, what's going on in that space.
So like I said, I rise, I wash, I meditate for 30 minutes. Then I make a cup of black tea and watch the milk foam in this milk frother I just got that I'm super obsessed with. I watch it the full 2.5 minutes. And then I usually have, so I like to eat for the seasons. It's a little bit Ayurvedic. I don't know if you guys have ever heard that term, an Indian science. But anyways, so in the winter, I usually make scrambled eggs with spinach and ghee. And I'll eat that for breakfast. And also, it's really, it feels extremely nourishing to make my own meal. And then in the summer, I'll usually have a Dr. Littman shake. He's been my doctor for 10 years. He's a wonderful functional medicine doctor here in the city. And he has great products. The line is called Be Well. So that's in the summer. And then I do some sort of movement in the morning to move my body. My preference is dance. It just feels so joyful. And I feel so empowered by the time I get to mindful if I've moved my body in that way. So yeah, that's the morning routine.
Okay, I think we might be out of time. You can ask us after. Cool, so thank you guys for coming again.
Thank you.
So much. Thanks for watching at home.
So come find us. So Ellie from Mindful, you can go to 3 studios in the city, and it's MNDFL.
Yeah,
and no vowel.
Right, and anyone who's sitting in the room, I have free class cards for you, so come and find me after class if you want to come.
Cool. And thanks, Robin, from Live the Process. Check out her site. She has a wonderful blog, a lot
Beautiful.
Of cool interviews
and
content.
And the best yoga clothes.
And the best clothes. And come find us at Sky Ting, skytingyoga.com, Chinatown and Tribeca. Yeah.
And they teach together.
Yeah, we co-teach a lot together.
Yeah, it's really
Those
fun.
Are the best classes.
Bad party classes.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, guys.